Hello, once again. My name is Dainius Lašas. I'm moderator of the Nord at the conference. Let's continue. The first day, and we will finish this day with a discussion panel discussion what Nordic Baltic countries can learn from each other in general education. What can we learn? What models are most appropriate, for example, in Lithuania? And let's discuss about that with the five panel discussion participants who work in this field, Ineta Žimančiūtė. I have a description in English. She's a Lithuanian language and literature teacher. She's an artist. And she's a creative learning ambassador. Ramūnas Skaudžius,
Švietimo viceministras,
Vice Minister of Education.
Sėdi profesorė Vilija Targamadzė.
Vilija Targamadzė, Lithuanian education scientist, expert in education, scientist.
Turime Artūrą.
Artūras Žukauskas. Profesor Artūras Žukauskas.
Titulų gal kai kurių dar nežinau dabar, kuris yra
he's chairman of the Committee of Education and Science, Parliament of the Republic of Lithuania, former rector of the Vilnius University, and Kristupas Sabolius, a philosopher who simply wanted to be called as a philosopher, referred to as a philosopher. So thank you so much for joining our conference. We've heard a little bit about the Nordic model, about the Estonian model. What about these models? Could they be applicable in Lithuania? Are they reflected in Lithuanian schools? Do we speak about that? Do we follow these examples in Lithuanian schools? And if we follow, what we take from these models? Or maybe we create our own individual models, Lithuanian models. Ineta, could you comment? Because you work at school, you know the situation best of all. The national character. We Lithuanians like to have our own views on to have our own national models. And I don't think that we have much experience of taking some models from the Nordic countries, from the neighboring countries. And I'm very glad that this conference kind of constructs the bridges between the countries, because yes, we have common problems in schools. We have problems, a lot of problems in schools, and we don't have time to wander around. I'm personally more related to other countries' education models during my business trips in Sweden, in Estonia, in Germany. So I do know a little bit about their models. So actually, what I lack, what I miss in Lithuanian schools, the highlight to the competences and less focus on to the content, because competences could be developed with diverse content. More freedom could be given to teachers in Lithuania, and we could learn quite a lot from Scandinavian partners. Teachers want more freedom. Are you ready to give more freedom to teachers? What about our new programs, curricula? Do they provide more freedom to teachers? Is there a trust in teachers in Lithuania? A very good subject, because today we are updating the education content, education curricula, and trust in teachers is anticipated, at least in 30% of the content, to provide freedom to teacher to select to choose the content on whether he or she wants to give to sharing the knowledge or generalization or to take other relevant topics for children. So it is a proper time to speak about that. And we are thinking about the freedom not to give more freedom not only to teachers but also to school administrations and to municipalities. Ilya, you know our models, you know iterations, transformations. Is this a radical step towards freedom of teachers? I don't think so, because first of all, we have to return to the education science, and self-confidence and trust is very important. Administration of education is based on control so far in Lithuania, 30%, 50%. But if you are controlled, no results will be achieved. So other countries are more related toward the trust, toward the responsibility-based education. We will not change the model of administration of education, but then I can't imagine any changes in schools. On the other hand, we need to change the education programs, as we heard from the Estonian example, teacher education. Will our teachers be ready to work according to new curricula? I learned one lesson from our famous Professor Meilė Lukšienė. She showed me general education programs. I was young then. She told me, if teachers will not believe it in these programs, they will remain on the shelves in boxes, on the tables. Now, Artūras, what about the laws, Lithuanian laws? Will we have the system in place which will enable the teachers become more independent and surpass the Estonians? Someday we will, but today our main problem is that not in the approaches. In the implementation, that's the problem, the implementation. Stanford University professor said once, success and misfortune, winner and loser, the difference is the implementation, not strategies, but implementation, because we do have the system, but when we come to implementation, then we have fragmented implementation, disproportions. We increase wages, then we require better outcomes. We establish school networks, then we think about other. There is no one single implementation plan. There are no good or sound implementation skills. And this is our culture, is Lithuania together with Poland. We've been celebrating 230 years. We've created the first constitutional monarchy in the world, the first European constitution, the first constitutional monarchy. But this didn't save the state from the collapse. And in Lithuania, on the basis of Vilnius University, the first education ministry was established, the Educational Commission, at the end of the 18th century, and it was the first commission in Europe to implement the education standards in schools from Lithuania to Mariupol, to Belarus, Ukraine, and Poland territories. But we did not become the most developed states in Europe, and therefore we suffer a lot because of that. So to my mind, we need to focus more to implementation, because we do have a lot of ideas. We see the world, we watch the world, so we know what to do, but when we come to the point how to implement, then we face the problem of cultural management, of management. Kristupas, do you think that this problem is really, really relevant at a higher level? You are a teacher at the university. You meet with the graduates, with school graduates. And when they come to the university, do you see that in the reality the level of knowledge is lower, or maybe this is to do with our neurosis? I've been working quite a lot with pupils, with students, and with teachers. We've been cooperating with the Creativity School projects. We worked quite a lot with teachers and pupils, and I can compare the systems because I am engaged in the reality, school reality. I do see the processes, and the distribution is uneven in national schools. This is, of course, related to the former schools who later become students. There are schools in Lithuania. Nobody have never ever entered university. There are schools, and with no graduates to study at the university. Yes, we do have progressive students, pupils entering universities, entering any university, and what is behind my words? I don't see the problems in the younger generation. I don't want to complain about the younger generation, but the situation is uneven in Lithuania. To my mind, there are a lot of problematic points. For example, if we take Klaipeda, Vilnius, Kaunas, Šiauliai, with wonderful schools, teachers. But if we go deeper, you start seeing radical differences, and these differences maybe are related to the implementation. And to my mind, with the mindset and with thinking about teacher's profession, everything is around the figure of a teacher. We can speak about the plans, we can speak about the systems, but we have to invest a lot to teachers, to the places which are the most difficult for them. And they really face difficulties, and we have to double and triple our assistance to teachers. On the one hand, to upgrade their qualification. On the other hand, teachers sometimes have to face social reality, which is different, for example, radically different from Vilnius university or college with social tensions. And if we don't refer to this problem in a complex way, we will not see that teacher's role is the importance of the teacher's role, methodological, financial problems faced by teachers, the problems to make contacts with the reality. For example, challenges in Gargždai, Visaginas, and challenges in Vilnius. They are absolutely different in big cities and in small cities. Ineta, okay, if we speak about the regions, I didn't teach at school. I am a university teacher. Usually, the work with the lower grade students might seem easier. We can give more attention, more time to individual pupils, to each pupil. Today, it's vice versa in Lithuania. Small classrooms, but outcomes are poor. Because as far as they know, they say, let's reduce the number of people in classes and we will improve the results. What's happening to your mind? Yeah, I was a teacher of a classroom with three pupils and 28 pupils. So I do have I can compare the, yes, with three pupils, to work with three pupils. Yes, you have a social contact, you can convey more knowledge, you can maintain this knowledge in children, in pupils. But I do understand that the average number of pupils in the classroom, 20, 22, 23 is the best. Why? Because we cannot separate the personality and learning and with whom they are learning. So the three pupils in the classroom, they were kind of naked each lesson. If this or another pupil didn't do, it's 100% that you will be asked. And sometimes when the number of pupils are high in the classroom, you can hide behind somebody's back. And, well, quite an interesting situation. Now I work with 27 pupils, and I thought, okay, I will face a lot of problems, but I started believing that big groups, they are better taking care of themselves socially, because when they learn or pursue learning process in a bigger company, they understand that if they make noise, they will face major problems. When I work with many pupils, I don't practically have behavior problems, and I can see that for learning it is very important with whom you perceive learning. So for you it was easier to manage a bigger group. No, I'm speaking about the learning efficacy or efficiency. Because, well, I thought that, okay, if there are three pupils in the classroom, it's okay. You cannot hide behind anybody's back. So professor, what is your opinion about that? Now we are speaking about the Millennium Schools, about reorganization of classrooms. What is the optimal solution? We speak about the measures. You speak about the measures. But what is the goal? In Lithuania, the measures are mixed with the goal. The size of the classroom, the organization of the network. What is our main goal? The personalities are different. If, for example, a pupil has no sense of security, as Aneta told, three pupils in the classroom, there is no comfort, there is no security, safety, micro environment. He feels or she feels bad in a small classroom. We have to refer to the variety of pupils. It is very difficult to identify or to define the maximum number of pupils. We have pupils with disability, with different social economics environment. You cannot say that 15, 20, 23, or 28 is an optimal number. But we have to decide somehow. Or the standard is absolutely irrelevant. One in the classroom, 21 is okay, but there should be some limit, 20. According to the research. But don't forget that we are stuck in the system, 21st century. Moreover, that we have the experience of virtual environment. We have to change the organization of schools. The schools have to rearrange their activities. So what is your opinion in the situation, in the context of a pandemic? Digitalization, as a country, where are the new solutions? You told about the revision of the education content. And what about the perspectives? About the perspective of the model in general. Are we speaking about the hybrid model? Maybe we think about more time to individual. What are the reflections in this context where we are today?
Labai gerai gerbiama Vilija paminėjo.
Yes, I do agree with Vilija. We must not mix the measures, the instruments with the objective or goal. Why we have those small classrooms? Because there are no pupils in this or another area, and we simply have to maintain, to sustain the school in this or another region. And when we speak about the reasons why we need to join the schools, well, coming to the question, how we change, could change the attitude, more responsibility is given to pupils. They are responsible, more responsible now, because the relationship between pupils and teachers about, for example, in the Nordic countries, more than 70%. Voices given to pupils in the United Kingdom. Yeah. So we have this transformation currently undergoing, and teachers are more courageous to adapt technologies. And we're thinking about the hybrid classrooms, not only, well, in terms of pandemic, but we need to think about the hybrid teaching, about different digital teaching instruments to make the content more diverse and in order to adapt to individual needs. Estonian representative said that they are measuring the skills. We not only declare or suggest, but they measure digital skills. They measure digital skills of the teachers. What about Lithuania? We participate in the international research. Our abilities are increasing, but I have to acknowledge that we need more efforts. We need more efforts for observation and measurement of knowledge, not only international research, but to measure the achievements during the lesson itself. Okay. The role of the parliament in this transformation, digital transformation. What is the role of the parliament? What can the chairman of the committee in the parliament with his team to enable us, to empower us in the 21st century? The parliament is what we managed to win several millions to the needs of digital teaching for procurement of computers, content, I don't know. The ministry has to decide. But the parliament has the function of the observer. Yeah, we receive information, but we have to understand that the cards are in the hands of the government. Referring to the digital teaching, we overestimate this aspect. Speaking about the digitalization in schools, it was inspired by the pandemic recently. In the universities, well, digitalization happened several years ago, many years ago, and it was really useful. And we see from the research that it was really very useful. The Bologna process participants are discussing this problem. But actually, we have to understand that those distance methods, virtual environments, they only give the free the teachers from the routine activities and save time for teachers to give more time to the socialization between the teacher and student. Is this the case?
Aš manau, žiūrėkit, iš tiesų čia gal pritarčiau, kad...
I would agree with the fact that we cannot regard technology as panacea. Goes without saying that we have to make the best use of the possibilities that we have. Those working at the university know what I'm talking about, meaning the very fact that you are connected to a class online doesn't mean that they are really involved in the educational process, because the quality has decreased, engagement rate has increased, meaning if compared to vis-a-vis or face-to-face, you're talking about university, yes, students are not involved, but again, there are certain just advantages. Or you can invite lecturers, distinguished lecturers from foreign countries, guest speakers into my classes, and students have this unique opportunity to get, well, I would say, first-hand knowledge and to listen to such esteemed well speakers. Because but for this opportunity to have decent learning, they would never be able to do that. Yeah, because technologies, I think, as philosophers say, since Plato times, up to Schiller, technology is both medicine and poison at the same time, meaning that it's very important to take the required dose of this technology. And I think, let's go back to students in high school, right? We have online classes for high school students, some of them very conscious, and some, particularly in problematic regions, they actually, in chat, they write some curse words, because, yeah, and on the presentation. So then it's, you should ask yourself, how can we manage, how can we handle these challenges? I even noticed a thing like, sometimes the addresses of public, let's say, classes are leaked, okay? And then all those Allah sort of worshippers can make their comments. So this is one more threat. So we have to think of how to better work with teachers so they know how to use those technologies and how can they really handle the time so they have more free time to cooperate with collaborate with the students. How about here? Yes, I think yes. It's a good thing. I can save lots of time because I don't have to go physically to work and back. But, regrettably, this additional workload, for example, a student sends his or her, I don't know, kind of thesis or kind of some kind of presentation, and if he hasn't written his or her name, then I have to actually, to try to find his name or her name somewhere, and it means additional working time. Yeah, I think it's a balance of advantages, disadvantages. I am not a fan of technologies, but I surprise myself. Why? Because this situation of today makes us seek a new and innovative solutions of how to make it more compelling, more attracting, to capture their attention. If it would be difficult to introduce these innovations if we were in classrooms, physical classrooms. Whereas now, here and now. So I think simply we have to use our imagination. We have to, yeah. Maybe the challenge is to actually direct those potential hackers to be more constructive. Maybe we should kind of involve them somehow so they use this destructive energy for some constructive purposes. Well, I work with children who have not yet reached the age of hackers, but I heard from math teachers that it takes about a minute to hack, meaning when they have some math tests, a minute to hack them, and the following during the following test, it's even, I don't know, a speck of a second. All right, let's go back to some other issues that we discussed today. The relation between school and teachers and parents. What's the situation in Lithuania, and do you think parents are prepared? Do they show the readiness, the willingness to be the shareholders? Because judging by the experience gained in the Nordic countries, we understand that parent involvement is an integral part of the Nordic educational model. Arūnai, what's your say?
Santykiai su tėvais.
Relation with the parents, school parents. Vėlgi,
kad turime gerų
pavyzdžių. Seems to me that we have good examples, and it works in some places, but it's not uniform situations, fragmented, I would say, as is our educational system. But this is the desired outcome, and I think these good examples are contagious. In what way? How can they spread? In natural way, or some measures are introduced to spread this kind of experience? I don't understand. I understand that, let's say, this elite school, Vilnius Lyceum, I understand that certain practices are introduced, but maybe it never reaches some small school in the countryside. I think the community has to be ready for the school itself, has to be ready to take up this model. And we try our best to collect the examples of good practice and then to share them.
Vilija,
your opinion on the relation between school and parents. I'm going back to something I started with, control. If we talk about the concept that was drafted in 2013 and 2015 was adopted by the Seimas, the concept of the good school, meaning it has to be based on consensus, meaning that the school has to be ready, and the parents have to be ready, and the community has to reach an agreement. Because we used to, to talk about unification. Now we are trying to centralize many things. If we do not allow schools more autonomy, if we do not have enough trust in the school principals, a school council, or school community, what's the point then for a teacher or a parent to establish this relationship? How do you think this lack of trust is expressed, is manifested? Meaning, how do you know that parents do not trust teachers and vice versa? Just a simple example. As of today, we keep talking about personalization of education. But I hear from those working in the education ministry and the others that at the same time we keep talking about individualization. What's the difference? Individualization, personalization is oriented towards the on the child, okay? Whereas individualization is something different, and we're not ready for that. Maybe these are the subtleties of words? No, these are paradigms, learning and teaching, different paradigms. If we're not ready for personalization, or if not ready for this digital content, so what, how come, we cannot even expect the parents' trust in our process of education. This is an ambiguous environment. We say, all right, we'll give this digital, provide this content, but who has to provide this content? So the teacher is stuck in a vicious circle and he has to get ready himself. Now, meaning individualization is a good thing. And once again, if we talk about competences, try to compare the old and the new curricula. So what's competence? There are its values, its skills, its abilities, yeah, but we have to measure them, right? And nobody seems to know how to measure them. So everything is so complicated, it's so, meaning there's no certainty, there's confusion, uncertainty everywhere, prevailing everywhere. So let's start with basic things. Okay. Got it. You're saying that, let's say, Arturas said that everything is okay with our legislative framework, and Vili, you said no, everything should be start from scratch. No, Vili said, I never said a word about the legal acts. No, they're okay. Implementation, enforcement, that's where we have to focus on. So meaning, I know that those who draft secondary legislation, they don't even understand the content. Okay, I just remembered an idea voiced by the Estonian speakers, and I'm looking at Kristupas. So the Estonians kept repeating that combination two words, growth mindset, meaning I can grow, I can be engaged in self-development, I can achieve something. So maybe we are on the wrong track. We keep looking at the parents, or looking at the teachers, maybe. Oh, that's wrong. Maybe we should change this paradigm. We should start thinking that, yes, I can. Growth mindset. And this is something that's going on between the teacher and the student. And if the teacher can inspire the students, if he has growth mindset, then the student will follow suit. Yes, this is nice, growth mindset. And as opposed to closed or stuck mindset. And we know that the critical element in this mindset is the ability to overcome obstacles or deal with challenges. Those who have a growth mindset look upon everything as an opportunity for growth, whereas those with a closed mindset see obstacles everywhere. But here, we're talking about mindset, all right? And
tiek mūsų proto, tiek aš kūrybinio mąstymo dalykas. Mes
pirmiausia part of creative thinking, I would say. Mokytojo. What does that mean? We have to start with empowering the teacher. And no secondary legislation will help us here. What is needed is trust and also some instruments which could be pragmatically applied. So we're talking about the Nordic experience, something that could be adjusted in Lithuania. I am part of the project together with Finland and Estonia about education based on phenomena. This is something very difficult to achieve in Lithuania. Education based on phenomena. Meaning, when we look at some phenomenon which is not broken down into subjects, and just a classical example, if you want to open a cafe, meaning you need math knowledge, Lithuanian language, design, some basic economic knowledge. So the Finnish model is widely discussed, and there's some criticism as well, but I think lots of advantages. And this model is known for continuous critical thinking, not to be afraid to step out of the comfort zone. This is very important. So I'm not sure to what extent teachers can cooperate, collaborate, meaning to arrange integrated classes, let's say Lithuanian language and physics at the same time, blended class. Can they do that? Yes. Okay. Yes. Last week we had, let's say, class information technologies plus Lithuanian language. Oh yeah, I know, but you're creative. But how about the other teachers? But I think that this could be the starting point. And when we talk about the university level, we talk about transversal competencies, cross-curricular, etc. But I think it has to start at school. And what does that mean? This means empowering teachers. So they can be involved in this creative thinking. And I could go talk about that for hours, but if our value is to be able to go in this direction, meaning creative thinking, so you can unlock your subject, your discipline, so that it goes forward. And this is, I think, is critical, and this is something that is really lacking in Lithuania, right? One more question is... You know, I guess, all of you, that you can come up with questions on Slide platform with the hashtag NordEd, and I will read a couple of these questions and ask some of you to provide your answers. All educational changes are implemented after some research. How is how are educational reforms implemented in Lithuania? Arturi? This is not a question, this is a statement. Yes, of course, 100% right. Because if you want to start implementing something, you need to have knowledge.
Yeah.
Knowledge, yes. We don't even have a good term in Lithuanian. This is...
have
to be equipped with knowledge. And this is something that is missing in Lithuania these days. And I have been initiated the certain amendments, let's say. I think that we have to... We need this research-based program, which is called education, no less to be included into the budget, no less than 5 million per year. And it's of paramount importance to include into this program higher educational establishment students and teachers, etc. And this, I think, could be the turning point. And of course that science and research is the basis, and this kind of knowledge is the basis of any activity of the 21st century. We have forgotten that. We don't have program, we don't have a resource, something that could on a continuous basis fund this program. So I hope we'll manage to do that.
In 2019,
Lithuania organized the meeting at the national level between the education professionals. One of the decisions was we have to make scientifically based solutions, decisions, that we don't need give enough time to research. One group or one person is not enough. And when I review programs, curricula, school curricula, I can see that we still lack research, scientific research. I've heard criticism from the educologists that competences have been for a long time, have been stuck. The science was not financed, the competences are getting lower. There is only one way to start financing the competences. Even the teacher education programs, qualification upgrading programs, they also need to be based on research and related to teachers and to scientists, researchers. We have to speak not only about the teachers, but about the university teachers. We have to revise and update programs. This is also related to university college teachers. If you are not creative, how can you help teachers develop creativity skills? A few comments, measures important for the achievement of goals. Our natural sciences have to be taught in the laboratories. So the question is concerning the Millennium Schools. Is this the decision that higher grade pupils could learn in super gymnasiums, and which afterwards eventually will bring everyone to the bright future? Yeah, the Millennium Schools, we will publicize the concept of the program. We will provide more details about the program, but we do anticipate to give more attention to the establishment of the laboratory. We anticipate financing or funding of this laboratory. It is also anticipated to open STEM centers, open access centers for pupils. And in 2023, we anticipate 10 new centers in Lithuania. But for that, we need the empowerment. We need the relationship with schools, networking, building active contacts in schools, so as to enable the pupils perform or execute research in the laboratories. So it will be kind of duplication centers and gymnasiums, or am I wrong? Continuity is very important. If you have to have the possibility to continue your and to develop or to upgrade your abilities, not only at school. 3 national centers, 7 regional centers. I am from X school, from province. For me, it will be very difficult to get access about the duplication, about the money, how to travel. When we speak about the details, everything seems very nice in Lithuania, but what we lack is lack of systematic thinking. What pupils we are speaking? Main, basic schools, preschool, upper grades.
Elitism.
Mr. Lašas repeated that a very good school is Vilnius College, far from the Nordic approach. Well, I simply state the fact that Vilnius College is one of the best schools in terms of achievements. Professor Žukauskas does not agree with me. Okay, I don't want to disseminate elitism. To my mind, Vilnius college pupils must not be selected. It is one of the problems, because people in Vilnius college are selected. This is in contradiction to the current teaching concept, because pupils need to learn different people with diverse needs, have to learn in the classroom, and it will create a better value than if we, you know, collect people from richer families to private school, and then we will praise the achievements. On the other hand, I agree with Kristupas that, yes, we do have schools with no graduates studying at the university. So in order to avoid that, we must not have those elite gymnasiums.
Parodyti visuminį vaizdą problema, nes daugelis tai supranta kaip integralų mokymą, kurio savokos skirtingos. Mm. Už nugarų menų mokytojų nusprendėte menus išmesti 11.
Yes, teachers decided not to teach arts in 9-12 grade. You will direct towards competences. I don't agree with you, and I'm
gal kas norit apskritai sureaguoti dėl tų programų ir vat
any reactions regarding programs, because we very often speak about the competences, about digital competences, about mathematical skills. What about the arts? The soft part. Is it under-evaluated? Maybe we only mechanically perceive the field of for the development of competences. Ramūnas and Kristupas. Well, creativity, the arts, yes, it is a very important part of general education from primary to the graduation. And I think that creativity must come via certain methods, via the changed mindset, via the decisions on how to implement the content. Arts lessons are eliminated? No, I don't agree with that. I want to highlight that the lessons of art, to my mind, we want to give more even hours to these lessons, and we want to improve quality. We want to improve quality of content. The arts are not eliminated. The lessons of art are not underestimated. Regarding arts, the pandemic provided a possibility for us to think in general about the arts. Everything and was closed. All the institutions related to arts have been closed. And maybe upper grade students complain that art lessons are not given proper attention. There is this parents' approach is also relevant. They say you better study mathematics. It's more important, and to my mind, it is a mistaken thinking and not the right thinking. I've been working in the school where the arts lessons are equal. There is not an exceptional discipline, and there are theater, singing, dance lessons in the 11th, 12th grade, because the arts is to kind of the objective of the arts lessons is to somehow distract students from mathematics, for example, and other more difficult subjects. What about the imagination? Kristupas. Now, the floor is yours. We've had a project with 10 Lithuanian artists as scientists, as researchers. We prepared 10 video lessons for school, And all the 10 artists worked with the hard learning instruments. Mindaugas worked with bacteria, and he organized the exhibition on the basis of bacteria, on how they are related to our emotional state. Or it was an artistic research. And together with the scientists, he worked together with the other scientists. Gediminas with his wife worked on another natural projects about the systematic and the cyber role of the... You have to understand that art is critical for all of us. It is kind of an access to knowledge, assisting the science to unlock another perspective. So first of all, we have to decide on what is behind the art when we say the word art, because the arts are very often referred to as kind of decorative, that we some to add something to what is serious, to make this or that subject to make the situation more relaxed. If we evaluate the art is the same stage for dissemination as for the dissemination of knowledge. We have to search for and to develop this area. We simply lack the interaction between different areas. What I want to highlight in this discussion, we have to bring all the disciplines closer. We have to start discussing the disciplines from early, at the beginning of in earliest childhood. We have, for example, Jaime Estate, a very famous artist, is related to the restructuring of the estate in Jaime. He has to create a new house under certain circumstances, and this is done by an artist, because scientists and researchers don't have time, don't have resources. So in this respect, we need to understand that the connection between art and research is the connection between art and research in general. Now we are coming to an end of the discussion. Briefly, one more subject. We are jumping from one subject to another, and there is nothing better in that. But I have an impression, while listening to the presenters in Estonia, I'm speaking about the achievements in terms of content, about the achievement and starting from primary school to upper grades, not to allow the gaps to occur between or among the grades in Estonia. They won't allow that. Is this not one of the key problems in Lithuania, that we do not manage to manage the process from early age? In fourth grade, a pupil moves to fifth grade with Mark 6, and he has serious problems. This means that in grade 5, he will not understand some serious issues. And in sixth grade, seventh grade, he will start hating mathematics. So Estonian success story, they try kind of manage to fill in the gaps. And we in Lithuania, we simply close the eyes, and then we have the outcomes. One of the reasons why we do have these gaps, we have other complex problems, the size of community, qualification of teachers, trust, the content of the curricula. This is not the only problem, and we have to solve it differently, in a systematic way. I will come back to what Kristupas has said at the beginning of the discussion. Bad teachers, bad pupils, it is not, this is not the problem of Lithuania. In Lithuania, it is a disruption between the best and the worst. Is very, very small. And in Lithuania, this disparity is very, very high between the worst and the best, because quite a lot of schools in Lithuania are not able to prepare pupils for studies at the university. If we take our best schools and Estonian best schools, there are no differences, major differences. But the problem is that there are no systematic approach, that our education system has not been managed effectively for quite a long time. So today the major goal of education is to make all schools sound or effective. We are a small country. We should not allow ourselves to have a poorly operating schools. We don't have many bad working, non-efficient teachers, because sometimes children know English better than English language teachers, or pupils know more than a teacher of informatics. So that is a problem.
Tai kiekvienas vaikas gautų tai, ko jam reikia. Taip kad čia yra problema.
So here the problem is not in the models, is not in the paradigms, education paradigms, because anyway, eventually we come back to the education system itself. We have to make all efforts to arrange the school networks, to invest to teachers, to provide a possibility to every teacher to grow in his or her field. And we have to surpass Estonia one day, because we have more potential, as they told Estonians. These are the words of the Estonians. Do you agree with this evaluation? Do you agree with Artūras that this separation, the gap between the best and the worst, is our bottleneck and hindering the development of teacher education? I do agree with the statement that we are, Lithuania is too small a country, and we are underestimate the problem. We don't give enough efforts. We don't perceive the situation, or the importance of the situation. When we speak about the pupils with the special education needs, and only recently we started speaking about the special needs pupils, although we did have these children for a long time, and some time ago they've been simply referred to as lazy bones, or just simply strange pupils. So still there are a lot of gaps in this area in Lithuania, with children with autism spectrum, on how to identify them, on how to educate teachers, on how to educate parents. with autistic children and not to refer to these pupils as to a problem, but to refer to them as a probability opportunity. So we still have a lot to do. And we have quite a lot of opportunities. Okay, I would like to thank participants of the discussion.
Vilija Targamadzė, Artūras Žukauskas ir Kristupas Sabolius. Ačiū Jums labai ir ačiū visiems,
kurie
sekėt, žiūrėjot, diskutavot ir susitiksime jau rytoj.
And we will meet tomorrow.